Good afternoon. This is Carrie. Can you guys hear me? All right, thanks.
All right, I think we're gonna get things started. Thanks everyone for joining today. First off, maybe I'll introduce myself for those that don't know me. My name is Don Vu. I'm Northwestern Mutual's Chief Data Officer and since March this year, and I'm driving the company's enterprise data strategy and the organizational transformation that comes with it. Of all my responsibilities at Northwestern Mutual, one of my favorites is working on the Northwestern Mutual Data Science Institute alongside Carrie McConnell and our university partners, the University of Wisconsin in Milwaukee and Marquette. Today, we're going to be hosting the NMDSI Impact Speaker Series. The Impact Speaker Series is designed to broaden people's view of data by exploring the impact of data and data science in various contexts and businesses with a variety of guest experts. This thought leadership series shares research trends, best practices, and modern technologies through an open dialogue through NMDSI's partner organizations and beyond. In our last session, we were fortunate to have Bill Franks from the International Institute for Analytics and Kennesaw State University And when I told him who we had teed up for today to follow him, he was really excited. He is an acquaintance, a colleague, comrade of our guest of honor today, Mr. Peter Fader. So Peter Fader is the Francis Peiwan Chia Professor of Marketing at the Wharton School of University of Pennsylvania. He's an expert on customer centricity. He's also an author of multiple books, including the Customer Centricity Playbook and Customer Centricity, Focus on the Right Customers for Strategic Advantage. Beyond being an academic and author, he's also a practitioner, and he's co-founded and continues to run Theta Equity Partners to commercialize his more recent work on customer-based corporate valuation. He also co-founded a predictive analytics firm called Zodiac in 2015, which was sold to Nike in 2018. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Peter Fader. Great to see you, Peter.
Don, always great to talk to you.
Yeah, and for those that don't know, we actually have a personal relationship. So prior to coming at NM to NM, I was at Major League Baseball for 13 years. And it was within that context that I got to first meet with Peter Fader at his Wharton Customer Analytics Initiative. We talked about things like churn and other very customer-centric data science types of applications. So really excited to continue the conversation. And it's funny, having come to NM and been at other places, I find that the problems with data aren't always the same, but they rhyme. And customer centricity and the focus on understanding who our most valuable customers are, treating them differently is pervasive and consistent no matter where I've been. But really grateful and fortunate to have you here today.
You know, and what you just said, Don, it's so true, and no one argues with it anymore. You know, it used to be that people were just so siloed, not only in their job functions, but in their sector. And that, you know, the issues we face, the data we have, the questions we're asking are different than yours. And it's just great to see people like yourself just kind of just busting down that myth and trying to bring as much learning as possible from very different domains. And we're seeing that whole kind of spreading of the gospel becoming more rule than exception. And that's great.
Yeah, we're all trying to collectively fight the good fight. So I'm really grateful to have had your friendship over the years. And we're going to talk a lot about, really, and we were chatting about it, I think, a little earlier, the pervasiveness of your influence having been in so many different spheres over the years. But maybe we'll just start with like the academic side of the world. And again, one of the things I've greatly appreciated about your perspective over time is being an academic as well as an author, but really a practitioner, seeing these, it's not just theoretical, but actually leveraging a lot of these methodologies on the ground. But maybe we'll start with the academic side and start with something that's really affected all of us. But can you chat a little bit about COVID-19 and just the impact of this on Wharton and on you as a professor?
Sure. So with respect to me and the school, I'm sure that you and everyone could predict. It's working from home. It's, you know, putting on a collared shirt over the shorts, you know, all that. It's first that great disappointment of I got to teach to a camera instead of to real people, but then it's the recognition that, you know what, I got to teach differently. I got to chop up the content. I got to communicate differently, interact differently, and that keeps things actually kind of lively and vibrant instead of just following the script. And I'm more and more convinced that a lot of things that we're doing because of COVID will continue to persist, will become best practices even when we get back into the classroom. So always looking for silver linings. And if you look hard enough, you find some.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree with that anymore. I'm trying to make the best of it, adapting. And it feels like from an academic perspective, professionally, we all have had to do that. I remember seeing a meme early on about who's driving digital transformation at your organization. It had like CEO, CIO, and then COVID. And of course, COVID was the one that was actually the one that was circled. But yeah, I would say that we've kind of irrevocably changed with everything we've had to deal with short term. So great. No, so thanks for that. So I did want to actually talk a little bit about some of your authorship. So I've greatly appreciated your books over the years. And more recently, the Customer Centricity Playbook, which is your newer book. You have lots of great examples of customer centricity in action. I was wondering if you could just share, you know, one of your favorites, perhaps, for all of us to talk about.
Oh, sure. So there's a difference between what's kind of, you know, the best example that's within the book versus the one that had the most impact on me. I'm going to answer the latter. And I'm not saying this, Don, just because of our longstanding relationship, but I'm really saying it from the heart. It's probably a lot of the work that I did with Major League Baseball. It was just really great around 10 years ago when MLB called me in to address one specific tactical issue. The issue, it doesn't even matter that much. And I viewed it as an opportunity to go beyond that one issue and say, you know what? Your real problem isn't that issue that you're thinking about. That's just a symptom of the deeper set of issues. The issue is lack of customer centricity, the lack of understanding of who the fans are, how they differ from each other, and what kind of data we should be collecting, combining, what kinds of analytics we should be applying to it, what insights we should be drawing from it, and what kinds of decisions we should be making as a result. And one of the reasons why I liked working with Major League Baseball so much, not only because I'm just such a big fan of the sport, but it was a really unique opportunity, unlike almost any other business I've worked with, where I have 30 different businesses who on one hand are competitors, but on the other hand are, you know, meaningful, legitimate collaborators. And so it was really great to work with the clubs and say, hey, Washington Nationals, why don't you guys work on on a loyalty program? And hey, Cleveland Indians, why don't you guys work on dynamic pricing? And hey, San Diego Padres, why don't you work on forming closer ties with your local community? And so a lot of the different building blocks that we'd like to bring them all together for any organization to be customer-centric. It was great to be able to test out each one of 30 different little petri dishes to try to find out what works when, under what circumstances, and then have the clubs get back together. And some of that actually does show up in the book. We actually have a profile of one of my former students, Royce Cohen, who has been heading up all the business analytics and related kinds of stuff for the world champion Los Angeles Dodgers. So it's been just really great to be able to form relationships with a variety of different people, impact a number of different organizations, and then see that impact spread throughout the whole ecosystem. That's pretty rare.
Yeah, and I think you actually characterize that perfectly, this notion of petri dishes and these kind of isolated, for all intents and purposes, isolated experiments that you can then scale league-wide. So I think that general like construct of test and learn and iterate makes a ton of sense. I mean, that's critical for success of so many different types of initiatives. So great example, of course, close to the heart. Could you share a little bit more about some of your commercial kind of enterprises? And so I was really, I hadn't talked to you in a while, and I saw the newsflash about Zodiac when it had occurred, and then now certainly Theta. But I would love to hear more about Zodiac. It's like super interesting initiative.
And it's super wonderful to talk about that story. You know, Zodiac was born both out of opportunity and frustration, because for years and years I've been developing these models, and I really want them to be commercially applicable. I know that they are. Not only do the models work, but they scale, and the implications that arise from them for decision-making are really, really important. Yet I'd go to companies and they would dismiss me in lots of different ways. First of all, they'd say, well, you're an academic, you know, like, really? Or they'd say, yeah, your models are probably nice, but you know, I'm the CMO. I need to focus on the brand. You know, all that analytics stuff, sure, we'll get to that too, but it's not really important. Or people coming up with the excuse saying, well, my business is different. Going back to some of the siloed ideas. My customers are different. My challenges are unique. My business is constantly changing. Your models might have worked for some data sets that you looked at 10 years ago, but they're no longer relevant. So one of the main reasons to found Zodiac was to go to companies and say, I told you so, that the models really do work, and they work for you too, and they can really make a difference. And it was a wonderful success. It was so great to work with a variety of retailers and travel and hospitality and telcos and gaming to basically say, look, here is the value of each and every customer. I'm going to wave my magic wand and come up with the projected value of each customer. That's sort of nice, but then let's help you make decisions on it. So let's figure out which email to send to which people in order to squeeze that value out, enhance it, and find more valuable customers. And even as we were getting Zodiac off the ground, again, finding good success with it, there were still companies hiding behind those excuses. And then Nike swooped in or swooshed in, whatever, back in 2018 and said, we want it. We want it all. And it was just a wonderful outcome in so many different ways. Besides, it's always just nice to tell your company. and the impact that it's had on Nike. I can't get into a lot of the specifics, but you look at their performance every quarter since then. But so many companies, all of those skeptics, all of a sudden saying, hey, work with us next. So to the way it legitimized the models, the perspectives, the practices, wow. I mean, I can't imagine a better company to have sold to give that kind of credibility. And I'm just so happy the way that it's played out.
Yeah, and when I think about the fundamental components of customer centricity, I think about how you have these customer lifetime value predictive models that, you know, aggregate all this data, leverage it, and then understand who our best customers are based on their lifetime value and lifetime spend. And it's just been interesting to see how, for some people, that's not an easy concept from a business perspective or various other areas, like to kind of get your head wrapped around. I think you being able to package and make clear and crisp the actual business value and impact of understanding this and leveraging it to change the way you engage with customers, maybe have deeper relationships with them. I think that's been really interesting to see it at the scale of like a company like Nike and all these other contexts in which you've actually applied it. So,
and yeah, Don, that's the hard part. I mean, you hit the nail on the head. I've had some success, but I'm also kind of naive. And I always believe that if I can just give people the CLV magic wand, that money will just show up. But unless you really can translate it to actual tangible business outcomes, unless you can get buy-in across the organization, it's just not going to happen. Then it's just going to be kind of a toy. So I've been very lucky that whether it's the 1-2 punch of, you know, writing the books to kind of get people to be aware of these concepts and motivated to want to pursue them, and then having this technical tool to actually make it very real. So you could call it good planning on my part, or you could call it serendipity. I think it really is more of the latter. But each part has really reinforced the other. And so it's been great to see companies, and whether they're working with me, with my models and perspectives or not, but at least trying out some of this customer-centric type of stuff on their own. Not always a success, but at least to give people the courage to try and some concepts and tools that can help them get there.
That makes a lot of sense. I'd love to hear a little bit more about Theta Equity Partners, which is your current project. And the notion of applying LTV to value companies is pretty fascinating to me. So can you just chat a little bit about that?
I will. And this one really, stay with the baseball metaphors, came out of left field. that one of our clients at Zodiac was actually a private equity firm. And they said, you know, we're not interested in your inactive tool. We don't really care about which email to send to which customer. We just want to know, what's the value of that whole customer base of that digitally native women's accessory company or whatever that we're thinking of acquiring? And that the idea that if we can project how many customers are going to acquire and how long they're going to stay and how often they're going to transact and how much they're going to spend when they do, that's going to help us do a better job of forecasting revenue, free cash flow, overall corporate valuation. So they were working with us at Zodiac, and after we sold the company, had a conversation with them, and they said, keep on going. And we started bringing in more and more private equity firms, other investors, working with companies directly. It's just been fascinating, this idea of customer-based corporate valuation. Now, keep in mind, I'm a marketing guy. I'm still on thin ice when I start talking about finance and accounting and all that sort of thing. But what I found is that, number one, it's an incredible use case for the models, even though it wasn't top of mind. Number two, it's in some ways more game changing for them than some of the tactical stuff about which email to send to which person has been for marketers. And number three, most importantly, it's helped companies build a meaningful bridge between the CFO and the CMO. That we can use the same models for that tactical stuff, as well as to, you know, talk to the board and our investors, and just be able to just go back and forth and have everything all synced up. Again, it sounds like I've been sort of planning it all out that way, but it really was just right place, right time. But now that I found that connection, I'm just doubling down on it, both in terms of the marketing finance connection. I'm trying to think about other use cases for other folks around the organization that can be just as impactful for them.
That makes a lot of sense. And you talked about serendipity, but you know what they say is like luck is where preparation and opportunity meet. And you've definitely been grinding away at this for quite a while. So we'll just leave it at that, maybe. So you've given great examples of how predicted LTV, predicted customer lifetime value, can be applied to in a bunch of different areas, whether it was at Zodiac, with Nike. You've shared about the customer-based corporate valuation. I mean, I have to selfishly ask, you know, and I've considered it too, and I won't spoil it, but thinking about Northwestern Mutual and insurance, you know, we're definitely, you know, have one of the core pillars of our data strategies around customer centricity. Do you have any advice for us as we go down this path? Any pitfalls that we should be watching for?
Absolutely. And it's actually a good chance for me to give a little bit more background about myself, because I'm a reformed actuary. So when I was at MIT as a math major, I was taking the actuarial exams, got 10s on the first two, did an internship with a big insurance company. So I figured that was the path I was going down, until some marketing professor came along and said, "You're getting a PhD in marketing." What? And basically, all I do today is actuarial science, but applied to customer behavior. And it's just remarkable that instead of predicting, you know, how long until you're going to die, I can predict how long until you're going to buy. And just a lot of the methodologies, a lot of the limitations, a lot of the use cases apply surprisingly well when we change the kind of behavior and the entity that we're looking at. So one of the things that's always surprised me, frustrated me about insurance companies, so I'm not picking on Northwestern, I love Northwestern Mutual, long time policyholder. So it is the fact that you got all those actuaries who are working on all that, you know, insurance stuff, but it's relatively rare for them to kind of move onto the business side and help drive some of these kinds of decisions as well. So I mean, there's the big piece of advice is unlock the actuaries from that windowless office in the back over there and say, "Hey, come help us run this thing." And I know that there have been some conversations like that going on there and elsewhere. But I think there's a lot that can be learned surprisingly directly without a whole lot of translation necessary.
No, that's awesome. There certainly are brethren for the data science org, and we have a good partnership. So that's a good call out. So one other thing I wanted to talk to you about was when you talk about your LTV model specifically, and we won't get too granular with it, but I was just curious, like, how have you, is there something you could speak to around how they've evolved over the years? I guess you've had so many different perspectives, again, from an academic, an author, and then practitioner, and certainly different applications from a practitioner perspective. Can you just share a little bit of how that's influenced and maybe matured or evolved your models over time?
Absolutely. Let me tell you a couple of quick stories that I rarely tell. You know, for most of my years at Wharton, at least through the 1990s, most of my work was on new product forecasting. So it was less about anything about the customers, or just how many of these widgets will we sell? Wrote a whole lot of papers on different aspects of new product forecasting in lots of different domains, packaged goods, music, sports. Right around, sounds so weird, the turn of the century, the academic journals started getting bored of that work. It was good work, but they said, enough of that already. It's a solved problem. I'm too lazy to actually start working on something new. So I just took the same methodologies, the same problems, and just turned them 90 degrees. So instead of saying, you know, how many customers will buy that product, it was how often will this customer buy the product. So it's a lot of the same methodology. It's surprisingly similar. And right there was a big wake-up call towards customer centricity. Because if you think about it, the ultimate unit of the analysis really should be the customer instead of the product. So it kind of made a lot of sense conceptually. Then it also opened me up to different kinds of methodologies that were very closely related to what I was doing all along, but were even better suited for predicting what a customer is going to do over time. So right around 2001, I didn't discover, again, I'm not going to take credit when I can't, but I stumbled into existing models that, if any of you know my work, buy till you die models. Silly name, I didn't come up with it. Basically, how many times will you buy this thing until you churn? And it was like putting on a pair of glasses for the first time. It's like it just puts such clarity to be able to predict customer behavior, to be able to tell a story about it, and to come up with the managerial implications about what it tells us. So it was kind of that 1-2 punch of being forced to change and then just, you know, looking around, doing my homework, and then finding some approaches that were like, whoa, really good, but vastly underappreciated both by academics and practitioners. And basically for 20 years, I've been shouting about these kinds of models, trying to make them accessible and popular. That's the stuff that underlies both Zodiac and Fade Equity Partners, and to get companies, not just the technical people, but the managerial people, to make decisions in accordance with them as well.
It's so interesting, but because I feel like so much innovation and some of these serendipitous unlocks can only be facilitated by just context switching and having different perspectives. And you've done such a great job of that, and just navigating all the different seats that you've had over the years. So that's awesome.
And maybe that, because look, I've been doing the same job for 34 years, you know, not only the same employer, but the same thing, just projecting stuff over time. So maybe just to kind of keep myself sane, to keep the juices flowing, I'm constantly looking for different use cases, different methodological tweaks and so on. And so the range of use cases for these models, again, some of which I can take credit for, a lot of which I can't. So it's not just customers buying things over time or policyholders making claims over time in the insurance setting, but so many others, whether it's animal tracking, you know, how many times will the mountain lion walk by that tree over there? Or with library books, how many times will that book be taken out? Can we put it in remote storage or do we need to keep it on the shelf? And lots of other cases. I've applied it to pediatric asthma. I've applied to so many different cases where on the surface you'd say, well, that's different. I mean, you can't take a model about custom behavior and apply it to mountain lions walking by trees, but you can. And so just almost being a hammer looking for nails. And admittedly, you know, there's some creativity and resourcefulness there to think of those use cases, to reach out to the right experts, to find the right data. And I just find just great joy in doing that kind of thing.
Oh, that's awesome. So I want to do like 10 more minutes of questions and we'll open it up to our audience. But I did want to chat a little bit about, I guess, a couple different things. I guess if we've had really good discussion about the impact of your models in various industries, we talked a little bit about insurance specifically and a little bit how your models have evolved. One thing I'd be curious to know, could you share maybe something about your personal journey that others might find surprising that's been really key to your career? I mean, you talked about the actuarial piece. I actually feel like you've almost answered it there. Mm-hmm. But is there another kind of like anecdote? I feel like so many, you have a very specific area that you specialize in, but I know that there's more to Peter Fader than that. So
I got two things for you. First, the silly, which is not really part of the personal journey, but it's part of the personal wackiness. I don't know if you're aware of this, not or Don, but I collect dollar bills with interesting serial numbers. So nice. So it's kind of interesting. In the opening screenshot for the session, you had a $5 bill there. And my eyes go right away to the 8-digit number, and I ask myself, how cool is that number on a 0 to 100 scale?
Nice.
And ever since I was a little kid, I've been collecting, here's some of them right here, dollar bills with interesting serial numbers. And I own the domain name coolnumbers.com. Check it out, people, coolnumbers.com, where you can put in any 8-digit number and it will tell you on a 0 to 100 scale how cool that number is. So that's awesome. Kind of weird. But as far as the personal journey, here's a surprising thing that on one hand, rarely talk about, I should almost be ashamed of it, but I'm actually proud of it. What just a terrible person I am. What a horrible leech I am. That so much of my success isn't just my doing, and I'm, you know, talking about finding all these use cases and all that kind of thing. It's actually riding the coattails of my students. I take such pride in my family tree. Working not only with folks who have gotten PhDs with me, but even lots of students who simply took one course. But, you know, I mentioned earlier, Royce Cohn at the Los Angeles Dodgers and so many other folks. So I'm just always curious to see what they're doing and whether their activities might tie in with some of mine. And maybe they have some good data for me or some good use cases. And I've just been so incredibly fortunate to be able to find people saying, you know, your models might apply here and there. And so whether it's, you know, writing papers with my PhD students and kind of, you know, getting my name in there, even though it's their work, or working with so many different companies and being able to collaborate, being able to, you know, I don't want to say take credit for their successes, but enjoy their successes. I mean, it's just all about, we know it's all about relationships, but in particular, that professor-student relationship is so special. A lot of my colleagues look at me and say, why do you waste your time setting up LinkedIn groups with your students and all that kind of thing? And I look at a lot of these successes that I've had and I say, you know, that's why. Because if you can find the right ones, you want to take full advantage of it. It's kind of like the subtitle of book number one, just take the word customer out, put student in there, and the rest follows.
Yeah, I mean, having known just the influence that you've had over the years, as I call it, like the Fader coaching tree, kind of like Belichick, or maybe Fader Mafia, maybe is another way to put it. So, no, that's great. One other question I want to ask you while I have you is, if you could give one piece of advice to a company that wants to tackle LTV and really use it as a lever to transform the way they operate. And I think about two lenses, whether you're a startup or an enterprise company, do you have any advice in either of those contexts for how to tackle LTV?
I have very different advice for the two. For a startup, you're actually too young to really be doing the customer centricity stuff right off the bat for a variety of reasons. You don't have enough data yet. The customers you've acquired aren't necessarily representative. The best customers are still out there and you just don't know who they are or where they are. So for a startup, it's just build the infrastructure. Recognize that you're not going to be able to flip that switch for, let's say, you know, 3 or 4 years. But to start that CRM system, to start tagging and tracking every individual customer, to just, you know, keeping track of everything about them. So when it comes time to flip that switch, you don't have to go back and say, oh my God, we don't have any data for those original customers. So it's build the infrastructure, build the culture, build the mindset. Whereas for an established company that might hopefully have some of the data infrastructure in place, but doesn't have the culture in place. You know, they found success through the product or the service. And now for whatever reason, whether it's opportunity or desperation, they're starting to make that pivot towards customer centricity. And it's hard to do that. It doesn't happen overnight. And it's actually really dangerous if the CEO has an all hands meeting and it hangs a banner on the lunchroom wall saying, we are now customer centric. You're doomed to fail if you try that. So you got to start small. You got to start with little experiments. You got to find one isolated group of customers and get kind of a committee of people and say, let's try to do the customer centricity thing with them. Let's figure out how we do it. Let's figure out how we talk about it internally with our colleagues. Let's figure out how we measure it. Let's figure out after those first initiatives fail, how we can fix them. So it's going to be just a lot of little trial and error experiments. And then just sort of spreading out through the organization. Again, you can't just wave the magic wand and just hope that success happens. So again, very different recipe for different kinds of companies.
No, that makes a ton of sense. It really does. Cool. So, and one of the things on a more personal note, one of the things, and we talked about the pandemic to start, and I did want to ask about this question. One of the things that I miss with the pandemic is live sports and travel. We talked about sports before. When you have the chance to travel again, is there a first place that you'll go?
Absolutely. I'm already starting to book the trip. I just love traveling the world and I miss doing so. But one of my favorite places that really embodies so many of these principles, again, whether it's the strategies, the methods, and just the openness, where a lot of that kind of resistance that I was just referring to just kind of isn't there, is the Nordic region. So I'm already booking a trip to Stockholm. Just so many of the companies over there, whether it's the ones that everybody knows, like the Spotify's, or some of the startups there, or even just some of the telcos and others. I just love spending time over there. In fact, it's going to be a student trip, so bringing a whole bunch of my MBA students and learning for those companies and doing a big compare and contrast with what we see in the U.S. So it's Stockholm for me. Fingers crossed, June 2021.
That's fascinating that like certain geographic regions or countries have a larger focus, or it resonates more, this customer centricity gospel in a sense. So are you saying like, so that area and that region in particular?
Yeah, the Nordics are great. Central Europe is also really good. It's kind of ironic because US is not, they've had great success here, but it's not at the top of the list in terms of willingness and ability. There's just too many companies here that are so deeply entrenched in, you know, old school ways that they're trying to fight it. But I'd rather work with companies where it's a bit more of a clean slate. There's a bit more of just kind of a culture that naturally embraces some of these things. See the same thing down in Australia, just easier to get going over there. The nice thing is that I'm not going to, you know, go all the way around the world with you right now, but I can come up with different kinds, either different sectors or different aspects of customer centricity that resonate in different parts of the world. So every place I have a hook to try to kind of get in there, but at some places the doors are just more wide open than others. Scandinavia being an example of that.
That's fascinating. Yeah, it was interesting. I hadn't realized Australia as well, but makes a ton of sense. So the last kind of personal question, and I think we have a bunch in the queue for the Q&A, and we'll hand it off to Carrie to help us moderate that. But so I worked at baseball for over a decade, and a major part of the game is a batter's walk-up music. If you had to pick a song as your walk-up music, what would it be?
Oh, I love that question, Don. Let me tell a story. It's already been chosen. So I mentioned, actually, I mentioned it just before. When I was working on the MLB project, the different things with all the different clubs, and doing a lot of work with the San Diego Padres. And I remember going to a game there and sitting with, at the time, the president of the Padres, Tom Garfinkel, who now runs the Miami Dolphins. And this exact question came up. So we're sitting with some of the executives, what would your walk-up song be? And when they asked me, I totally panicked. I spaced out and I couldn't come up with a good one. That's unusual for me. Usually I'll think one that would have some kind of clever thing. And so the only song that I had kind of in the back of my mind was Thrift Shop. You all know that song, Thrift Shop, by Macklemore. So that I declared that's my walk-up song. So there you go.
Thrift Shop. I wouldn't have picked that one for you, but
exactly. But and you heard it here first, people. I don't think I've ever told anyone that before. So let's crank that one up. So.
Awesome. No, that's great. So great. No, so this has been a great conversation. I do want to get some of this Q&A. And I mean, for us here at NM, I feel one of the things that really attracted me and really drew me to coming here was. And most folks don't really think about this. When I thought about like customer centric companies and you think about the notion of a mutual, I mean, you talk about being customer centric, like literally all of our profits go into dividends back to our policyholders. It was interesting to kind of think about that in the lens of customer centricity. So this conversation has been extremely relevant. So thank you so much.
Sure thing.
So with that, I think we'll tag in Carrie McConnell, who's our co-director at the NMDSI and on our team here at Northwestern Mutual. Hey, Carrie.
Hello. Hi, Peter.
Hey.
Thanks for joining us today. This has been fun. Now I don't know the song Thrift Shop, so now I gotta go listen to it.
Or you can avoid it. No. At least don't listen to it around kids. That's all.
I don't have any of those in my
house. Not safe for work, as they say. Anyways.
Well, we've got some great questions in the queue here. I'm gonna start with a question that came from Ashish Merchant. And he asks, he or she, I apologize, in India, at least, so many companies aspire to measure CLTV, but I've rarely seen organizations who actually know CLTV with a good degree of confidence. Any reasons you can guess why that might be the case, and how can we help change that?
Yeah, I can't wait to get over there. You know, we have at Wharton, we have a working relationship with the Indian School of Business in Hyderabad, and I can't wait to get over there and teach my course and spread my gospel. Because you're absolutely right. There's just so many folks there who have the technical skills. They have just a thirst to run these kinds of models and make decisions on the basis of them. And I've had the good fortune of having lots of conversations there, but I've never seen widespread traction. So I agree completely with what Ashish is saying. A couple of reasons why. Number one, data quality. You know, it's a culture where There's still a lot of people paying by cash, and so it's just harder to tag and track individuals doing things over time. There hasn't been, again, it's going to vary from one company to another, and I don't mean to, you know, criticize all of India, because US is the same in this way. There's not quite as much investments in, say, the CRM infrastructure. Too many companies say, oh, that's just a cost. We can't afford that, instead of seeing it as an investment to understand who those customers are and what makes them different. So it just hasn't been prioritized quite enough, but I have every reason to believe, and again, from some limited examples that I've had with some companies there, that surprisingly, the basic patterns of how many customers we acquire and how long they stay and what they do with the horizon, what they spend, the same models fit just as well over there as they do over here. So I'm just waiting for that kind of breakthrough opportunity. And I don't know if it's going to start on the marketing side. Maybe we'll start more on the finance side for valuation purposes or you know, one of the other use cases. It's going to happen. So Ashish, you know, let's make that a reality. I think it's a really great opportunity.
And just given the size of the market, I mean, it is such a copycat situation. When someone has success with it, right, and gets some traction, then I can imagine it just scaling very quickly. It's such a massive market. So
yeah, that's why I am confident it will happen. And again, some of these limitations on, you know, payment methods and data infrastructure, those are all just temporary things. And we just know, especially as the whole world moves to mobile payments, then it's, you know, game over, or it's game begins at that point.
Yeah.
Thank you. So I have a question from Ahmed here, who asks, do these valuation models and frameworks differ from Professor Aswath
Damodaran.
Wow, you knew from New York.
Oh, absolutely. Everyone knows Aswath Damodaran. He's, first of all, a wonderful person, but maybe the most famous professor working on corporate valuation at NYU. He has been so supportive of the work that we've been doing. In fact, some of his blog posts and just other talks and things he's given, you know, many a shout out generally to this idea of kind of bottom-up customer-based valuation, as well as specifically to the kinds of methodologies that myself and my former student slash co-founder, Dan McCarthy, have employed. So having his blessing has meant so much. There are few people who have the respect of a field like he does. So he's been talking about closely related stuff for quite some time, but I think we've helped him have just a much sharper focus on this one idea, and he's helped us just gain kind of legitimacy and visibility for it.
Awesome. It sounds like education, it's a core value, right?
Yeah, and it's so nice, actually, when a finance professor, because let's face it, you know, in the business school jungle, the finance people are the king of the jungle, right? And so a finance person to kind of endorse what a lowly marketing person is doing, it's just so nice. It really means a lot.
So do you see any synergies between customer centricity and blockchain as a book of record?
Oh, well, again, going back to our ability to tag and track customers and purchases, I think there's tremendous potential. I'm actually a little surprised slash disappointed that we haven't seen as much of it yet. So I've had a few conversations here and there. Like, there's a couple of different companies that are talking about kind of replacing traditional loyalty programs or something that's going to be more blockchain enabled, both in terms of being able to track and then, you know, anyway, all that. So yeah, I think there's just a lot of potential there. It's not really my expertise. I got to get me a student who's into that stuff and then kind of, you know, again, ride their coattails. But I really do think that it's inevitable that blockchain technology takes over. It's just a matter of time. And this will be one of those excellent use cases that will help people understand, now I know why we're doing all that stuff, because we're still looking for some of those big wins.
Well, actually, Ahmed wants to know if you're taking on any new students to build your research work.
So. Oh, I always am. Sure. There's no question. But the problem is you got to pay the price. You got to take my
tuition.
No, not that. I wish I got some of that, but that too. No, you got to. Oh, more painful than tuition is taking my course on probability models. It's basically, as I said before, just actuarial science applied to different kinds of business settings. So that's the, you got to get your ticket punched on that. And by the way, for people interested, again, I've never said anything about this. My ambition for summer 2021 is to get a lot of that content in an online way. My partner in crime, Bruce Hardy at the London Business School, and I are planning to make lots and lots of videos to democratize access to all this content. So stay tuned, Ahmed. You'll have a chance as well. Or just come to Penn.
Oh my goodness. Okay, so many great questions here. Thank you.
Actually, I want to jump in because
yeah, go for it.
A question from Nikhil asking, is there any relation to the movie Moneyball? Now, we've been talking about all the sports stuff, and it's, a really good chance to draw a contrast. Because first of all, I think it's pretty obvious that not only do I love sports, but I love sports statistics. I was born and raised on that stuff even before sabermetrics was a thing. But it's actually very, very, very different. And this goes back to one of the points that I was raising in a different context before, that Moneyball became all the rage. Let's use all the statistics and the analytics to, you know, figure out player performance. But while the clubs were figuring out who that third round draft pick should be and what they should pay for him, they were completely ignoring all of that on the business side. And that was my frustration when I started working with the league, is we need to have just as much rigor and accountability and standards and successful outcomes on the business side, on the ticket selling and customer relationship building side, as we do on the player side. So on one hand, there's no relation to Moneyball whatsoever, because I'm talking less about, you might think about applying Moneyball to your employees or something like that. But on the other hand, of course, there is a lot of similarity, just like in that wonderful book by Michael Lewis, fighting battles, trying to overcome inertia and people who feel that their intuition will always be better than data and analytics. So, in that sense, there really is a lot in common. I'm just trying to think about, who will play me in the movie. If Brad's available for that.
Yeah, the funny thing about the Moneyball era is, like, to your point, on the business side, it did lag for a while. It took a while to catch up and get some stuff in place. But sometimes I would often say it's Moneyball for business when we were trying to push the ball forward in that sense. So
that's right. But once again, a lot of the clubs just weren't allocating enough resources or personnel to it.
Yeah,
and that's changing. Again, I'd like to believe that it was this project that I worked on a while back, or I think it's just a sign of the times. But it's just wonderful to see how that one industry, as well as so many others, have really transformed themselves in a relatively short period of time. Back to you, Carrie.
Well, I didn't know you saw my script, so I don't know.
Well, I'm just looking at the chat here. I know that's your script. Yeah.
So I have a couple of questions here about customer centricity and B2B. So question about, customer centricity in that environment with any context to rural Africa? And then how do you measure B2B corporate partner value?
Okay, so here's the weird irony of it all. A lot of these ideas, a lot of these practices have existed in B2B forever. So, if you're a company and you're selling, big ticket things, MRI scanners to hospitals or airplanes to airlines, you're naturally going to be pretty customer centric because, first of all, that your customers are very different from each other. And you know that you got to really cater to the good ones, both in terms of the price that you sell, the way you sell them, the other value added services that you bring to them. That's customer centricity, that not all customers are created equal. And if we can figure out who the good ones are and surround them with lots of sources of value to show them that we're in it for the long run. So B2B companies do this naturally. The hard part is bringing it to the B2C world, where there are millions of customers instead of dozens of customers. And so, you open up a mom and pop store and you just have a few customers walking in and you know everything about them. You can be very customer centric. Then you open up store number 2 or 3 or 10 and you move into a new geography and you kind of lose touch with all of that. And then it just becomes all about how much stuff do we sell and can we do it as cheaply as possible? My contention is we can take a lot of that mom and pop or B2B love for the good customers, and with data analytics and technology, continue to do all of that stuff at full commercial scale with millions of customers instead of tens of customers. So the answer is yes, 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 we can do it in the B2B space. It happens there naturally, things like strategic account management and all that sort of thing. Now that doesn't mean there isn't room for improvement there. And that's where the lifetime value thing comes in, because we know that there are plenty of cases where even in the small numbers B2B thing, where you're selling to certain companies just because you kind of, you know, you like to talk to them, you feel good about it, but they're not necessarily that valuable. And so I want to bring greater rigor, accountability, transparency. I want to help nudge those salespeople to spend a little bit less time talking to that account, a little bit more time to this one. And on the back end, use our CLV models to show how much ROI we created as a result of that realignment. So there's always room to improve the practices. And again, I'm completely agnostic about B2B versus B2C.
And I got to give a shout out to the author or the person who submitted that question. That was Corey Ruff from the aforementioned Fader Mafia, former student and currently at the Chicago Bears as VP of Business Analytics. So don't hold it against him, our friends in Wisconsin. And
well, so you, as Don mentioned, Peter, the NMDSI is really focused on deepening the data talent pipeline in Milwaukee and Southeastern Wisconsin. And so I have a question being asked on behalf of the students on the call. Peter, if you were a young undergrad, again, what data skills should I focus on? Programming, stats, visualization, engineering, modeling?
All of the above.
I'm going to say that's the answer.
but let me say, some of those things are pretty obvious. Some of those things are pretty cool and sexy, and you don't need anyone to bring them to your attention, especially all the machine learning kinds of stuff. All the cool kids are rushing into machine learning, and that's important, don't get me wrong. But there's too many people who have the belief that if I can learn that stuff, I know everything. But it turns out, so one of the things that you didn't mention on the list there is the stuff that I do for a living, which are the actuarial type models, more of the probabilistic type models. So, you know, questions that are a little bit less about who will do what when, but more about the understanding the uncertainty around those things. So a lot of the, you know, actuarial type probabilistic models, which have the tiniest fraction of visibility and interest compared to the machine learning. So I wanna make sure that that gets mixed into the set as well. And in fact, I would contend that some of that stuff, because the nice thing about my models, or I own them, is that they're inherently forward-looking. All the statements I'm always making is, you know, how many customers are going to acquire and how long are they going to stay? Whereas a lot of the other stuff that we do in the data science world is actually kind of backwards-looking. Like, I think visualization, for instance, again, I'm not saying you should ignore it, but I am saying it is a little bit overrated. You know, it's one thing to make pretty pictures out of the data and help us to understand what the data has been. But to me, I think that the data are dirty and disgusting, that the data are the outcome of some kind of as if random process. And what I'd rather know is the underlying story that drove the data in the first place, and that will explain the future as well. So I wanted to make sure we get, so what I usually tell people would be, a heavy dose of probability models, stochastic models, Poisson processes, all that kind of thing. Lots and lots of machine learning, being able to think algorithmically. Got to bring in the econ as well. You got to take that dose of econometrics and just overall data handling. So whether it's visualization, whether it's, you know, just managing large data sets, all the SQL kind of stuff. I think that combination of skills is vital. And I'll say one last thing. Believe it or not, even though I teach at the Wharton School and I love being here, I don't think you should be a business major. I think you want to be a major in one of those areas and really focus on technical stuff, focus on analytical stuff. All the business applications, you'll learn that later on. So I'd really rather you major in engineering, math, statistics, not business. Get your MBA later.
And if that excited you, you might have a career in this stuff, right? If it scared you, you still might have a career. Well, there's more questions than we have time, so I think I'm going to end with a really fun one. Michael wants to know if you play liar's poker with the dollar bills.
You know, I don't, Michael, but I have the market cornered because it just turns out that a lot of the patterns that I like the ones that I was showing before, here's a bill with no repeated digits, so you get an 8-digit straight right there. That's going to win. So I don't think I've ever played it once in my life, but if you looked at my shoeboxes filled with dollar bills, and if you're into that, you'd be salivating over them. Unfortunately, they're just like sitting on a shelf just because they're pretty. So I wish I could find a way, whether it's at the liar's poker table or some other way, to kind of create something useful out of the silly dollar bill thing. But you know what? On the other hand, if I did something economically useful, then people would question my motivations. So just as well, it's a stupid hobby, and I highly discourage you from doing the same.
Do you also use a mattress as your bank account? Or is that a different thing?
Yeah, that would be quite separate. Yeah, I might be stupid with money in one way, but when it comes to collecting dollar bills, I only do the ones.
Ah.
I said, once you start getting into the fives, the 20s, and the hundreds, it starts getting expensive.
So. Yeah, for sure.
So I limit my insanity right there. So.
Well, thank you. Apologies that I couldn't get to all the questions. We'll see if there's something we can do to capture them. Maybe Peter, send them over to you if you have time. That would be gracious. If not, definitely understand. Don, I think I'm going to hand it back over to you.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to close by saying thanks so much to Peter Fader for joining us today. It was an awesome conversation and obviously really easy. Please check out his books, follow him on LinkedIn, follow Theta Partners, and please subscribe to the NMDSI newsletter. It's been a great conversation and looking forward to continue it beyond today. So thanks so much, Peter, for joining us.
My absolute pleasure, Don and Carrie and everyone else for taking the time to tune on in. Absolutely keep in touch.
Awesome. Thanks. Take care, everyone.
Bye now.